for our salvation in Christ. It is why we're here. We're a family of faith, because we all have a common faith in Christ as our Savior. We have eternal life in Him, and we're here to worship You this morning. We ask that You would be pleased with what we do this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together, "All My Hope Is in Jesus." Dying for our sins. Amen. We're going to sing "Almighty, Almighty," that chorus.
Almighty, most holy God, faithful through the ages, Almighty.
I realized my mistake. I know, it's the double dot. The double dot will get you. Y'all go ahead and have a seat. Oh, goodness. I'm up here just as an example of how you cannot be perfect and still serve the Lord. Amen. I'm a walking illustration. All right. How great thou art. And again, we want you to sing at home with us about how great your God is. How great thou art.
Consider all.
He is worthy of our praise this morning. Amen. I tell you, every time I think through those lyrics as I sing, and I hope that's what we do. I know that you can get lost in the music and the worship, and your mind can be 1,000 miles somewhere else. But I hope that as we sing, we're thinking through these lyrics, because those lyrics are just so just, they're just theologically dripping about news of our salvation and what Christ did for us on the cross and about his coming again. And that's just it's a blessing. Honestly, that's one of those songs, if we sang that every Sunday, I would never get tired of it. I would never get tired of eating certain foods, and I would never get tired of singing that song. It's just some things you don't get tired of, amen? All right. Do we have any first-time friends with us this morning? If you'll raise your hand along with mine, if you're here worshiping with us this morning for the first time. Looks like home folk. And we're glad you're here this morning. We're glad, again, that you're here with us on Facebook live stream. Now, before we go over the announcements, we're going to have the pastor come up.
Just wanted to add my welcome and thanks for being here on our 52nd homecoming celebration. Last week, I announced that we had some difficulties getting our projectors and things working. Well, lo and behold, some vendors can't get it and others are missing and it's out of inventory, if you'll just type in what you want, you may still find it. And that's exactly what we did. So we've got some new bulbs back here, the big screens back up. And in just a little bit, we're going to have a special presentation of Homecoming's Past, which I think that you're going to really enjoy. And so I just want to add my welcome, and we'll say some more about our 52nd Homecoming in just a bit. And we have, for everyone here, everyone present, do not leave the premises without getting your goodie bag, grab bag that are prepared for you after the service. And so we'll say more about that at the end. God bless.
All right, by way of announcements, we all we know about the Zoom meetings. We have 3 Zoom meetings this week. The first one was Monday for the Gophers. That's at 6 p.m. The Word of Life Olympian, the Gophers, have their meeting at 6 p.m. on Zoom. Wednesday night, you have the Word of Life Teens and the Olympians at 7 p.m. on Zoom. And then Thursday, we have an adult Bible class at 8 p.m. And so if you'd like to be a part of that, adults, if you haven't been a part of that yet, get with Mary and she'll give you the invite on Facebook or whatever it is, and you can type it in and join them for the adult Bible class on Thursday nights at 8 p.m. They're still going through the book of Revelation, I believe. And so join them for that. And if you have teens or young children, get them hooked up to Olympians. Talk to my wife, Miss Carol. She's out in the back. She's our COVID czar. Or Jeremiah, the teen leader, about getting hooked in with the Zoom meetings on live stream or on the internet as well. It's a great way to extend the ministry while we're going through this time. So don't miss out on that. As we come to this time of our service where we worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings, we're not giving into the offering plate right now. We have 3 ways that you can bring your tithes to the house of the Lord. 1, you can mail it in. 2502 Lakeview Drive, Rossville, Georgia, 30741. You can do PayPal. Get a PayPal app and get on there, and that's the information that you need to go through and log in through PayPal. And you also have offering boxes. There's 2 out there in the vestibule as you come in. And if you missed it, there's another one right out here as you go out this morning, or this afternoon. Those were built by Steve Stapp. We appreciate that. And so those are 3 ways that you can still bring your tithes and offerings to the house of God, because the work goes on in ministry. Amen? All right, well, let's go before the Lord in prayer as we ask blessing on our tithes and offerings this morning. Our Father, we thank you and we praise you. Just to come together and to sing songs about our faith in Christ. All our hope is in him. For forgiveness of sin, for eternal life. We thank you. We thank you for the time that we've had already just to lift up your name in song and sing praises. Lord, we're thankful that this ministry has gone on this long in this church. It's evidence of you working in it. We couldn't do it on our own. This is not of our hands. This is not of our our labor. This is you using people through the decades just to glorify yourself and bring people to you, bring the lost to you, to be reconciled and saved. Lord, we are so thankful for the ministry of this church. And we ask continued blessing as it goes forward. As we come to this time where we give of our tithes and offerings, we ask that you would take what has been given, use it for your honor and your glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right. I want to sing that chorus, Learning to Lean. Learning to Lean. You all to stand, smile, and wave, and welcome one another this morning. I wasn't done yet. All right.
Seated. We'll welcome Miss Mary Phillips up. She put this together by keeping track of some pictures and some of the old timers you'll see from the way back. In 68, when the church first was in existence, all the way up till now. So, Miss Mary, presentation.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Boy, it's great to see you all. I've been a part of this church going on 21 years, and it's been a tremendous joy ever since. A lot of people have come and gone, and I see some people that are here joining us today, and I'm just glad you're here simply to worship the Lord. That's what it's about. great church family. We're going to start with just enjoying some pictures with a little bit of narrative by me for those who are real new, but not a lot. I want y'all to just lean back and enjoy. All right? Go James. So this is, as you see, it's the church as we are now, and you will see at the beginning here some evolving. That sign, and there's the old one. Both have served their purpose. It's been a direction for those who come our way. Those are pictures from the past, and that's the best picture of Sherry I've ever seen. And those are our deacons, and we'll show some pictures here of our remodeling, which you all need to know. A lot of the work that's gone into the remodeling of this room and in the back is by the hands of the members of this church. So I'm very proud to know these men. Few children are involved through the years. It's a very polished and beautiful look. When I see Mr. Dillard there, I know that everybody can get involved. Now we have coming up some of the folks that have passed in front of us. I'm not going to name them. A lot of you guys know that these people have been a tremendous impact in this ministry through the years. And a lot of them I didn't know, but a lot of them I got to know. And they were a blessing. There's three very special men. As you all can see, these people have truly impacted this church. There's some of the folks here that know that for sure. And I just want you all to know especially that I'm glad I was here for 21 years of that. What I enjoy watching is the smiles. That's an example that it's never too late. Mr. Rimmendorf, how old was he, Betty? 89 when he found the Lord. So don't stop witnessing. Don't stop walking the walk. Hate to say that's one of my very favorite pictures. Another one of Sherry. Those who deliver meals now, there's a picture of Mr. and Mrs. Morrison. They were deacons in our church, and they've been out of church, and we deliver meals to them, and we pray with them right now. It's how we continue with outreach. You're looking at a bunch of people there. One's a minister, one's a missionary. There's one of our pastors that have come through, not Todd. Todd's our drum guy. Todd's got two very special boys there. One is deployed right now. Please pray for them. I don't know if anybody remembers Mrs. Gurley, but she was very special. Still, she's still with us, isn't she? Thank you. Crazy guys that always help the women's ministry. And then there's our children. This is what homecoming usually looks like. I wanted you all to have a memory of it. This year we can't feed you. But know that the base of our population, our family here, is dependent on those who have passed through, those that are now here, and also the ones that we are raising up, our children. We are all about spreading the word of our Lord, His gospel. There's Heather at her best. If you can't name them, there's a family that we enjoy, the Centers, the Hills, the Durhams. Again, the children are now what we are to raise and teach in the way of the Lord. That's our fall festival. Don't believe we're having one this year because of these COVID business, but we're going to continue to reach out, aren't we, guys? See where music is a major part of our ministry. And we enjoy it so much. For those who don't know, that's my guy on the right. Also, drama is a major part of our ministry. Through the years, you can see that eating is a major part of our ministry. By the way, if I hurt your feelings, I didn't mean to. There was only 10,000 pictures. There's some of our older folks I really miss. They're gently putting their foot in the water and coming. And we're going to gently respect that you're here and take care of you. That's our Olympians. We could put them up for some manufacturing job, it looks like. By the way, we've had a lot of people die, we've had a lot of people born, and we've had a lot of people married. And it's a beautiful thing. There's our choir. If you need to see what Steve Stapp looks like, there he is. That's the guy that did the tithing boxes. Todd has had a haircut since. We've even reached out to doing yard sales, another community outreach. We tend to give away about 10 to 20 Bibles during that time. During the fall festival, we average between 100 and 200 Bibles given away. That was our first fall festival. Our team knows how to dress. As you look through these pictures, you'll see we have a lot of families that are very strong in the Lord and have carried through the years. And that is an example of how we teach our children. It's been beautiful to watch. That's Santa Claus on the left. As we wind down, I want you to know the outreach this church has started with this community has been extremely fantastic and a continual growth as we have undergone this virus. We're not going to stop. We're not going to let this slow us down. And I want to thank Brother Robert and Pastor Vince very much for their guidance and their direction. Amen.
Here, I'll take care of it.
Thank you.
All right. And thank Mary for putting that together for us. That was very well done. And, you know, I'm just sitting there and thinking back through all the memories as those pictures and slides were showing. And I'm glad, you know, a lot of people have asked me over the years, they said, why did you stay here at Bible Way? I mean, the way you do and the way you, the talent you have and the education that God's given to you and the skill you have, nobody handles the Word of God like you do. Why did you stay here at Bible Way? And for one thing, if the Lord wanted me somewhere else, he's always pretty good about letting me know that. And so for the first thing is God never gave me an inclination. Now, there were a couple of times I felt like I might want to go ahead and move somewhere else. Winford will know about those, and some of the old timers. Overall, we've had our bumps in the road, but nothing like some other churches have experienced by the grace of God. But the main thing is that when you love a people and they love you back, you can't beat that. You can't beat that. And so that's, I've stayed because God wanted me here. And it's not very many pastors can say, out of the 52 years of a church's existence, in another week or so, I'll be here 33 of those years. So it's been a good run. And it takes that kind of time and commitment to develop those love relationships and to have those kinds of relationships. I mean, I've been here when we've been smiling and laughing and cutting up, and I've been here when we've really been crying. There've been some tragedies in our families' lives, and it's just a good thing. Now I know it's a little disappointing with all of the circumstances of what's going on in the country here and all this pandemic and stuff like that. So I suppose, well, let me tell you first, I need to get you into the scripture. Let's take our Bible, turn to the last couple chapters in the whole book. Revelation chapter 20, 21, 22. We're going to look at the last couple of chapters of the book. Lord willing, we will return to our trip through the book of James next time we meet. But for today, we're going to look at Revelation 21 and 22, catch a verse in chapter 20. I always want to say hello to my mom. It was a beautiful picture of mom and dad up there, and I think the reason that Mary included them in that presentation is over the years, they have been here for many Father's Days, Mother's Days, homecomings, special occasions, and then sometimes just because they were visiting us, and they have had a direct impact on so many of us here at our church. I think my dad said on a number of occasions he felt more at home here than he did where he lives at the church that they went to. Nothing bad about that church where they went to. I just don't want to stir up nothing there, but you loved him and my mom the way you love us, and we appreciate that so very, very much. Now, this 52nd homecoming here with this COVID-19, I suppose when it comes to the throwdown meal and all that we normally do that we're not going to get to do this year because of the special circumstances, that if with considering that, and if that's a favorite part of it, and I think that was one of Robert's favorite parts on the foods that he would never get tired of eating, the gospel bird fried chicken, I think he likes that pretty good, and we all like banana pudding pretty good, don't we, Robert? And so we're missing that, and I suppose if all of that is the favorite part, missing the 2020 homecoming is probably, out of all the homecomings we've had, this would probably be the best one to miss if you had to miss one. Usually we kind of we've brought in special groups for singings and all that kind of stuff in the past. So I suppose that if you were going to have to miss one, this would be the one that would be the best to pick. Don't want to miss any of them, but this would be the best one because of the way things are. But there's coming a heavenly homecoming that none of us want to miss. None of us want to miss the heavenly homecoming. And when we think about heaven, what comes to our mind? What comes to our mind? I mean, white, puffy clouds, dressed up in white robes with wings. Some of y'all might look pretty good with them wings on. I mean, look pretty good. Carrying harps. Just lazing around all day with nothing to do. Is that what heaven's all about? Is that what heaven's all about? Well, not according to the Bible. Not according to the Bible. Revelation 21 and 22 give us much of the information that we know about the new eternal order that God has for believers. One of the reasons it's so hard to describe heaven is that it's not just another place, but it's another dimension. Revelation 20 leaves off with some pretty sobering words. Revelation 20 and verse number 15, if you can put that verse up for us, folks. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, this eternal separation of unbelievers from believers happens at the end of Christ's 1,000-year millennial reign of peace on this earth. And at this point, only the holy angels and those who have been redeemed by faith in Christ are around. That's all that's left. Because everyone else is in the lake of fire that burns with brimstone. Now, brimstone's actually an old English word. It's used for sulfur. Sulfur. Sulfur forms around volcanic vents in the earth's surface. O.J., our bass player and sometimes drum player and lead singer, when Robert's out, Jay and I went on a missions trip years ago, I think about 12 years ago, we went on a missions trip to Nicaragua. We had a great time. We had a great time there, and we had a good impact on that area. On one day, they did take us sightseeing, and so they took us to see the mouth of hell, active volcano. It's called the mouth of hell. And actually, when you park in the parking lot, because it's active, there's warning signs that if the volcano begins to spit lava to crawl under your vehicles. That was what the instructions were on the warning sign. Remember that, Jay? And we're thinking, okay. But we went up, and I will never forget, I got a big gulp of gaseous sulfur when I was leaning over the edge taking a picture of the mouth of the volcano. I mean, they would let you go right up to it, look down in it, you could see it boiling down there. And then, you know, fortunately it didn't spit anything out while I was leaning over it, but I got a big gulp of that sulfur, choking, the choking stench of sulfur. And the wrenching pain of being burned forever, that's what's reserved, the Bible says, reserved by God for everyone who does not accept the free gift, costs nothing, of the love and grace and provision of safety that God has given through faith in Jesus Christ. Can I have an amen? The truth is that some of the details of what's going to happen in the future are very clear from the Bible. And this is one such example. All right? No Christ-rejecting person, so to speak, has a chance in hell of ever going to heaven. Other details of our heavenly homecoming and where we'll be and what we'll be doing, they're a bit more hazy, but the last two chapters of the Bible do reveal some intriguing information about our future if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior. In many ways, what we will see is actually the return, God's return of us to the Garden of Eden and that type of paradise. But this time it'll be a city, as God always intended for mankind to have, where we can live and prosper in God's presence and God's grace and God's love. It will be a great heavenly homecoming, which none of us under any circumstances will want to miss. Can they have an amen? So let's walk through the final two chapters of the Bible, kind of envision what God has in store for us. I want you to look at Revelation chapter 21 and verse number 1, where the Bible says, and John the apostle here is seeing these visions and is getting this revelation and writing it down for us. And I, John, of Peter, James, and John fame, and I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Now, in our heavenly home, with our heavenly homecoming, in our new heavenly home, everything will be new and everything will be different. According to verse 1 here, all of creation is new, but it's different. Now, where our English translation reads passed away, the New Testament was originally written in the Greek language, and New Testament Greek literally reads the first heaven and the first earth are gone off, departed, and then we say have passed away. That's how it comes into our English version. Gone off, departed. Now, all of the scholars get together and they start thinking on these things. And there's actually three possibilities here about what happens to this existing earth. This existing earth, first of all, might be renovated and made new so as to remodel it according to its original blueprint before Adam and Eve chose sin and evil. That's the first possibility. Second possibility is that this existing earth will be returned to the original chaos before creation, and then it will be recreated with a new cleansed existence. That's a possibility. The third possibility, which I lean towards, is this existing earth is going to be destroyed and a completely new heaven and earth will be made. And that's what we're going to be a part of. Say amen. The new earth is minus oceans and seas. But as we'll see a little later on, it does have a river. Would you look back again at verse number 1 of Revelation chapter 21? And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. So there's a new city in this new creation is where we're going to live forever and ever in God's presence. And the Bible tells us and promises us, God promises us, that He will live with us in the new city that's going to be called Jerusalem. Would you look at verse 2 and 3 now of Revelation 21? And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be with them and be their God. Wow. That's going to be nice. This returns us to the state in the Garden of Eden where each of us could walk and talk literally with God in the cool of the day. That's what happened back in Genesis chapter 3. You can look at it later on. And from Genesis to Revelation, you'll find this repeated over and over again, this phrase. And I think it's a key part of the theology of the entire Bible. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. That's the goal, the absolute final culmination and goal of this whole shooting match, why this whole 9 yards, why we are here. That whole point is coming to this existence. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Say amen right there. Our new life is going to be entirely absent of pain. Look at verse 4 now. Revelation 21, verse number 4. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. You know, I think about this verse, and I think about the presentation that we just witnessed, and there was a long section of former members of our church that are no longer walking in the face of this earth. They are now gone on. There's gonna be no more death. Amen. Oh, come on. Y'all like going to funerals? Do y'all like saying goodbye to your loved ones? and friends and family? No. There will be no more death. Amen. No more crying, sorrow. For the former things are passed away. Verse 5, and he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Everything that caused pain and sadness on this earth will not be present in heaven. Say amen. Where everything about our lives is safe and secure, that's home. This world's not our home. Okay, this world's not our home. When we get there, as soon as we are conscious of our presence in the glories of heaven, we will have this overwhelming sense. We are home. We are home. Only two verses mention hell in these closing chapters, but they're pretty strong. I want you to look at verse number 8 of chapter 21 of Revelation, first of all. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers, drugs, and idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Now skip down to verse 27, last verse of this chapter. And there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defiles, neither whatsoever works abomination or makes a lie, but only they will enter in which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Now, in both of these verses, as I look down the inventory of sins that are listed, I always marvel at the fact that liars are on this list. You mean that little white lie that I told was enough to keep me out of heaven? Yes. When I lied to my parents? Yes. When I lied to my boss and employer? Yes. When I lied to my wife? Yes. When I lied to my husband? Yes. When I lied to my children? Yes. That's enough to get... See, God is far more perfect and holy than we can ever imagine. And that's why we need Jesus. That's why we need Jesus so much. The only way to participate in the future great heavenly homecoming is to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the only way to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life is to believe in our hearts and trust fully in our emotions and will and everything about us that Jesus died in our place for our sins, rose from the dead, and believe in him and receive him and live our lives for him. Say amen. That's the only way. that we're going to get our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, the new city of Jerusalem is called the Bride of Christ, the Church. Look back at verse number 9 now. Revelation 21, verse number 9. And there came unto me one of the seven angels which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, Come here, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Now, I'm told that if you ever fly into Las Vegas at night, that you will see what man's neon glory looks like. Well, the radiance from the New Jerusalem coming down from God and coming out of heaven, out of God from heaven, is going to be so incredible and so bright that it's going to make Las Vegas at night look like a dying ember in a dying fire. So you say amen right there. Our heavenly home city is nothing like we have ever seen. I want you to look at verse 12. Verse 12. And it had a great wall and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates, on the west 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city and the gates thereof and the wall thereof. And the city lies four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. Now, furlongs, we don't use that measurement too much in our common daily activity. A furlong is 220 yards or 660 feet. Well, there were 12,000 of those. The length and the breadth and the height of the city, the bride, are all equal. And he measured the wall thereof in 144 cubits, the wall that goes around it, according to the measure of men. Now, a cubit is 18 inches from the tip of the elbow to the tip of the middle finger, usually is the measurement, 18 inches. That is, of the angel. And the building of the wall of it was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. I'm told that if you refine gold to its purest, It has a glass-like appearance and sheen. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, second, sapphire, the third, chalcedony, the fourth, an emerald, the fifth, sardonyx, the sixth, sardius, the seventh, chrysolite, the eighth, beryl, the ninth, a topaz, the tenth, a chrysoprasus, I think, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, chrysoprasus, the 11th, a jacinth, the 12th, an amethyst, and the 12 gates, we'll stop there, amethyst. Wow, everything we value up here, they're using for gates up there. Wow. This heavenly home, this heavenly city, is nothing like we've ever seen before. Our new heavenly home's in the shape of a cube, according to these measurements and this description. 1,500 miles wide, 1,500 miles deep, 1,500 miles tall. The walls around the thing, if I've got my measurements correct, are 217 feet thick. The gates to our city are always open. Never, ever will one of God's people be shut out from his presence. The names of the 12 tribes of Israel are written on the gates. The names of the 12 apostles are written on the foundations. Both groups had an important place in God's redemptive plan. And so in our eternal city, their names will be honored and memorialized for all eternity. Now, John, he focused on this clarity and the brightness and the brilliance and all of the things that it was made of, the colors of our home. Now, I've told this story before, but it fits real good here, too. I remember reading a fictitious story. St. Peter gave a man who had died an opportunity to bring one suitcase into heaven of anything that he valued on earth. So the man walked in carrying what looked to be a very heavy piece of luggage. So Peter asked to inspect the contents of the suitcase. It was a shock. Peter could not believe it. The suitcase is filled with solid gold ingots. And in disbelief, Peter said, "Why did you bring street pavement?" You got to see verse 21. You got to see this. Verse 21 of chapter 21. "And the 12 gates were 12 pearls, every several gate was of one huge pearl," was made. The gates were made of one huge pearl. "And the street of the city was," what, congregation? Asphalt. They're using gold for asphalt. "The street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass." I'm telling you, the things we value down here are of little value up there. Can I have an amen? Glory to God. In our new city, there'll be no need for churches or temples or light of any kind, including the sun and the moon. I want you to look at verse 22 now. Look at verse 22. Stunning. "And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon, to shine in it. For the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it, and the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it." See, our final heavenly homecoming for all of God's people is so glorious and so blessed that we will not want to miss it for anything. Amen. Our heavenly environment is like nothing that we've ever experienced. Now I want you to look at chapter 22, the opening verses of chapter 22. "And the angel showed me a pure river." Told you there was a river there. May not be any sea, but there is a river. "River of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Amen. I think of the Hallelujah chorus when I read those verses. Now, I want you to notice the similarities between the Garden of Eden and our new heaven and new earth. There's a river, the tree of life, God's presence, and all that's going to be there. Everything's going to be there. And I want us to compare our heaven to an unbeliever's hell. Just several comparisons. Number one, in our heaven, light is always present. Don't even need a sun or the moon or a candle or anything. It's just always, it's light. It's light. Light is always present. In their hell, light is always absent. There is no light. It's the blackness of darkness as described. It's always beautiful day in our heaven. It's always darker than night in their hell. Pain is non-existent in our heaven. Pain is always constant in their hell. Love is everywhere present in our heaven. Hatred is everywhere present in their hell. God is intimate in our heaven. God is not even thought of in their hell. The tree of life will heal the nations in our heaven, but there's no healing, only injury and hurt in their hell. Tears are wiped away in our heaven. Tears are always flowing in their hell. There's no more death in our heaven. Forever, there's a living death in their hell. A river of life, crystal clear, is in our heaven. A lake of fire burning with sulfur is in their hell. Perfect rest and peace is in our heaven. Never-ending torment is in their hell. And that's the Bible. Every president, prime minister, potentate, and king from every tribe, language, and nation will kneel before the Lamb of God and recognize that Jesus Christ is Lord, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. The healing tree of life is there. It's going to give us health and strength forever. I mean, in the Bible, we're told you can't see the face of God or you're going to die. When we get to heaven, we get to see the face of God. We'll be able to sit down and talk with him face to face. Did you catch that? In verse number 4 of chapter 22, and they shall see his, what's that word, congregation? His face. They shall see his face and his name. He knows our name. Now, in verse 6 and 7 of chapter 22, we should understand the word quickly to mean suddenly. Would you look at verse 6 and 7 of chapter 22? And he said unto me, these sayings are faithful and true, and the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. Behold, I come quickly. There's that word. I'm thinking we should understand that as suddenly. Blessed is he that keeps the sayings of the prophecy of this book. To be blessed, we need to keep the prophecies of this book. That means we need to pay attention. And as James has reminded us in our study over the last couple of weeks in the book of James, we need to be doers of the word and not hearers only. We need to give heed to this book. Amen? We understand the sudden return of Jesus could happen at any moment, and so we repent of our sins and we live our lives for Jesus Christ to the best of our abilities. Amen? John's so overwhelmed in this vision, he just falls down and worships the angel who instructs him to do otherwise. I want you to look at verse 8 now. And I, John, saw these things and heard them. And when I heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel, which showed me these things. And then the angel said to me, "Don't do that. See thou do it not. For I am your fellow servant and of your brothers, the prophets, and of them which keep the sayings of this book." And you can underline the next two words. Say them out loud. Everybody together, worship God. And he said unto me, "Seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand." He's just so overwhelmed. Twice in the final chapter of the book of Daniel, which is a companion in the Old Testament to the book of Revelation in the New Testament, twice in the final chapter of his book, Daniel is told to seal up the prophecies that he received because they were for the end time. He's told that. But the prophetic words of the book of Revelation are not to be sealed up. Because the revelation is for us. It's for the church age. It's for John's time. It's for our time. That's why verse 10 says, "And he told me, seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand." Now, I know there's some denominations and some people out there that would teach you that you can get a second chance at heaven and eternity. That's not true. That is not true. The Bible is clear. You choose to be a part of heaven's homecoming now, or you choose to have your part in hell. After we die, all the prayer vigils, all the lighting of candles, all the cash donations to the church, not going to change. It's not going to change our eternal destiny and the choice that we make right now. You say, why do you say that? Verse 11. Look at verse 11. "He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still." Wow. Now is the age of grace. Now is the day of mercy. Today is the day of salvation. The Bible implores us, begs us to receive the free gift of God's salvation and deliverance and redemption. Now is the time. Don't wait. Do not wait. The Bible says our entrance into heaven is a gift of God. It's a gift of God by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. However, we're going to be judged. Now, it's not like we don't have to worry about it. All I have to do is, you know, get this thing out of the way and I can live the way. No. We're going to be judged for the good and evil that we have done while living on this earth. Would you look at verse number 12 now? And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. For outside, without, are dogs and sorcerers, which the Greek New Testament word where we get our English word pharmaceuticals, drugs. They're dogs, whoremongers, murderers, idolaters. And then again, whosoever loves and makes a lie. Now the word dogs there, that simply refers to unclean, immoral, violent, and liars. Unbelievers are outside from where God is. They're separated, they're alienated, they're isolated forever in darkness. In recent years, there have been some scientists that have written some books that some of our young people have gotten a hold of, and it has shaken their faith. One of those guys is Stephen William Hawking. He was a British theoretical physicist and cosmologist. He's known for his contribution to the fields of cosmology, that is, and quantum gravity. He received nearly every award the scientific community can give, and many still look to him and his writings as an authority on the origin of the universe. Shortly after his first marriage at age 21, Hawking began noticing symptoms of a motor neuron disease known as amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS. Hawking gradually lost the use of his arms, legs, and voice, and as of 2009, was almost completely paralyzed. Many of you remember him. He was on television, interviewed different times. He talked through a computer-generated voice. He was in his wheelchair, and he was all stoved up, and he could still talk. There's nothing wrong with his mind. He believed in aliens and said that we should avoid any contact with them. He wrote several best-selling science books. The Grand Design came out in September 2010. In his book, Hawking claims this: because there is a law such as gravity, the universe can and will create itself from nothing. Spontaneous creation is the reason there is the something rather than nothing. Why the universe exists, why we exist, it is not necessary to invoke God to light the blue touch paper and set the universe going. Now, blue touch paper is a type of fuse that's used with explosives. The laws of nature, he wrote, that are required for life forms to exist appear by pure chance. Dr. Marcelo Gleiser, a Brazilian astronomer and physicist of the same level as Hawking, he wrote in reaction to Hawking's statements. Listen to what he said. Contemplating a final theory is inconsistent with the very essence of science and physics. An empirical science based on the gradual collection of data. Because we don't have instruments capable of measuring all of nature, we cannot ever be certain that we have a final theory. There'll always be room for surprises, as the history of physics has shown again and again. In fact, I find it quite pretentious to imagine that we humans can achieve such a thing. Maybe Hawking should leave God alone. I think he was a believer. Say amen. So Hawking believed through the laws of physics that the universe is just kind of inevitably going to burp itself into existence. Well, my observations is this. If there are laws of physics, there must be a lawgiver, hello, who created the laws of gravity, the laws of motion, the laws of physics. Who created them? And so we're left with a choice here. That's what it comes down to. We're left with a choice. With no ability to verify his imagination, we can either believe men like Hawking and others who hypothesize and theorize and speculate how our universe began and don't believe in God, or we can accept the invitation of Jesus, the Lamb of God. The Bible reveals created us and can accept us and give us life eternal. Let's read the final verses of the final chapter of the Bible. Look at verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that hears say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. For I testify unto every man that hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. If any man take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifies these things says, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And all of God's people said, amen. The final heavenly homecoming for all of God's children is so glorious and so blessed. We don't want to miss it for anything. Let's stand. With every head bowed and eyes closed, you at home in our online congregation, if you will, please join us in prayer also with head bowed and eyes closed. Today, we have an earthly homecoming. It's changed from what we usually do, but we are marking the day. celebrates our church's ministry anniversary. We get to see some old friends, renew some acquaintances, share our worship together, fellowship, Christian love, just warms and thrills our soul. But our day here draws into focus another day in the future, where all of God's family of faith will gather for a great heavenly homecoming. And we want to see you there. We don't want a single member of our family or circle of friends to miss out on the glories of heaven. God has spoken, and He has warned you of the only other place in the next life to spend eternity, the lake of fire that burns with brimstone. You have the choice. You can trust Jesus right here and right now, or you can choose to believe short-sighted men like Stephen Hawking. The decision rests on your shoulders. Choose carefully. Think about it. If Hawking is right, and you live a life of faith in Christ and die only to find that there is no heaven, you haven't lost anything. But if Hawking is wrong, and you reject faith in Christ and die only to find out there is a lake of fire, you have lost everything for eternity. Choose carefully. What song do we have, Brother Robert? Let's sing that song. What a day that will be when Jesus we shall see. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. He's coming again. What a day. Second verse, there'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there, and forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a that will be. All of God's people said, amen. Amen. It's just a little homecoming. We want to be in the big homecoming. Amen. All right, if we can say so long to our online congregation, thank you for tuning in on this 52nd anniversary of our church's ministry in this location. And our church, we have touched many, many lives over the years, and we will wait till heaven to see the impact of our church. But thank you for joining.